All right, I'm here. Twitch.tv/110sports, 110sportsmedia.com/live. Thank you so much for joining us on a Wednesday. We're halfway through the week, and Anthony Davis didn't feel like playing like a big last night. Okay, let me rephrase that. Anthony Davis didn't feel like playing like a big the entire night. We'll look at a shot chart here in a second because it's pretty striking. But we'll get to that as well. Chris Brown's going to join the show here in about 20 minutes. Going to join the show in about 20 minutes. We're going to talk some baseball with him. We're getting very close to the end of the baseball regular season. We need to break down these playoffs, see what's happening over there, where we're standing right now. And I want to ask him about the playoff format a little bit. And now that we have a set of teams that we pretty close know what who the teams are that are going to be participating, I want to know from him who he thinks the playoff format benefits that might be in a tough spot. Otherwise, we'll go to all of that in about 20 minutes or so. I just talked with a class from Butler. The three of us, Josh, Chris, and I, all went on to talk about 110 Sports, of course. A shameless plug there. And then about being a Butler in general. Man, I miss school. I miss it. You know, all these kids sitting there freshman year. You know how much I would pay to go back to freshman year? Okay, maybe not as much as it actually costs for freshman year, but it, you know, college is so much fun, and missing out on the last basically semester because of COVID in a real way. You know, I was nostalgic for some Zoom classes and having to wear a mask in the class. Yeah, but that was a good time to get to chat with some younger folk and talk about sports media and about what we're doing at 110 Sports. But listen, first of all, and I said this at the beginning of the show on Monday, but not surprised in the slightest that the Nuggets came out and won this game, because the least surprising thing in sports is when a competitive team that's down 2-0 wins game three. The Nuggets wanted this game more than the Lakers from the jump, from the tip, and sort of they really controlled this one throughout. You know, they only won the first quarter by 2, but then went and won the second quarter by 8, up by 10 at halftime, then went and won the third quarter by 8-2, and despite losing the fourth by 10, controlled the game to the final buzzer. They really won this game by 10, Alex Caruso making a layup at the buzzer to pad them stats a little bit. But no, it was, you know, we were reminded of a couple things yesterday. One, that this Nuggets team is for real and a ton of fun to watch. I mean, the big story last night was the fact that Jeremy Grant was 7 of 11 from the field and 10 of 12 from the free throw line. He had 26 points, you know, second on the team behind Jamal Murray, who was also fantastic in this one. And really good down the stretch. He had a 3 from the moon to seal the game, I guess. You know, the game was pretty much over, but it took it from 8 or 9 to 12, and it was, okay, all right, fine, we're done. The game's over. But, man, this, you know, Michael Porter Jr. was really great early and then, you know, sort of tailed off a little bit. Monte Morris continues to be Monte Morris off the bench in a really, really impressive fashion. And this Nuggets team, man, they're just fun to watch, and they play really hard, and they're so likable. You know, way back before the season started, this was one of the rosters that I found the most intriguing. There were just a lot of dudes on this team that had me intrigued. And then, you know, at that point, I, you know, maybe you roll them up together and you get a star and a half. But you've got one superstar in Jokic and a guy who's very quickly getting there in Jamal Murray, and has certainly taken, if he wasn't a star yet, certainly has taken a step into, he's one of the stars of the NBA in the bubble. One of the more surprising but cool things that has happened in the bubble is sort of this emergence of Jamal Murray as a guy, as a guy that you can have be one of the two best players on a team that goes to the Western Conference Finals. It really has been impressive to watch him show up in big moments, in a way that he didn't show up in big moments last season. This is a game that they absolutely needed to win. He comes out, puts up 28, 12, and 8. 10 of 17 shooting, 4 of 8 from the 3-point line. He was great in game 7 against the Clippers. He is now showing up in the moments when you absolutely need to win. And now they've had 6 games in these playoffs that they absolutely needed to win, but in terms of games that aren't elimination games that you absolutely have to win, this is one of them because no NBA team has ever come back from 3-0. We're familiar with 3-1s, but 3-0s is not a thing in terms of NBA comebacks. He had 28, Jokic 22, 9 of 14 shooting, a much more efficient offensive game from him, 10 rebounds, 5 assists. He's just such an effortless passer. It just at least, pretty much every other time down the floor, Jokic is making a pass that even if it's not a complex one, you're just like, that was so the right pass, Like that was the best pass to make right there, and he does it a ton, and it is quite impressive. But the thing that had me going absolutely crazy in this game was Anthony Davis. Listen, let's talk about Anthony Davis's scoreline. 27 points on 9 of 17 shooting, 9 of 10 from the free throw line, 2 rebounds, 0 blocks. There were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 players who had as many rebounds or more than Anthony Davis. On that list, Paul Millsap, Jamal Murray, Michael Porter Jr., Torrey Craig, LeBron James, Danny Green, KCP, Rajon Rondo. And Rondo's a good rebounding guard. But the point being is that you look at this stat line, 27 points, 0 of 4 from the 3-point line, 9 of 10 from the free throw. You would think he's James Harden after this game. Now, he didn't take nearly as many shots to be James Harden in this game. But the point is still the same, is that if I gave you that stat line, the last thing that you'd think that person was Anthony Davis. What makes it even more infuriating, let's look at his box score for just a second here. And I'm gonna try to pull this up real quick. Just give me one second here, and we're gonna bounce around here, see if I can get this box score up. Okay, here we go. We're gonna switch screens real quick. Transition. Here we go. Here's the box score. His shot chart for this game. We're gonna center this. We'll make it completely on the screen. There we go. Anthony Davis. This is Basketball Reference. Not trying to steal anybody's stuff. This is Basketball Reference, for what it's worth. Okay. Let's take a look at this. First of all, he took 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 shots outside of the paint. 8. Half. So that's infuriating part number one. He missed 8. He took 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 2 of 8, 10. 2 of 10. He made these two. He missed the rest of them. He didn't miss in the paint. Dude. 1 of 1. 2 of 2. 3 of 3. 4 of 4. 5 of 5. 6 of 6. And there might be another one right in there. No, 7 of 7. There it is. He didn't miss in the paint, took 10 free throws, made 9 of them. He took 3 more shots outside of the paint. What? And then didn't rebound on the other end of the floor. In the fourth quarter, he took two shots, made one of them. He literally couldn't be guarded when he went to the rim. Literally could not be guarded when he went to the rim. But this is what he did. He took 10 shots outside of the paint. Missed 8 of them. It was like he was playing at the rec center against a dude named Bob who just got done with their day at the local accounting firm. No offense to dudes named Bob who are accountants. Accountants seem to be taking the brunt of my comparisons, especially when talking about average dudes. But literally nobody can. We've talked about this before. The Nuggets don't have somebody who can guard him. And now they went to They went to Jeremy Grant at the five for the first time in a really long time, and it worked. And Jeremy Grant was great, and that's why they were able to do that for the most part. But oh my gosh, this should never be Anthony Davis's shot chart. And Josh Doering, my buddy here, who is the co-host of the Jaystudays podcast, he said this on the pod, and it makes so much sense. And you know, at the time I was like, listen, dude, he just scored 31. He had 22 in the second half. He went to the free throw line a ton. Like, let's give him a break. But 27 in this game. Oh, my bad. That's the wrong screen. Forgot I was sharing. 22 points in the second half. But he basically did the same thing here. This isn't enough points in the paint. It's just not. You can't be Anthony Davis and have your shot chart look like this. You can't do it. It's absolutely infuriating, and it would be so much less infuriating if he was struggling all over the floor. But look at this. Look at he's 7 of 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 dots, green dots, no X's. He can't, and this is why LeBron is still the guy and not Anthony Davis, and there was no talk about that, but this is why Anthony Davis is 1B to LeBron's 1A, even in a series in which he's the ultimate mismatch, because LeBron understands things in a way that AD just doesn't yet. And AD is still so bogged up and not wanting to play the five ever and not wanting to, you know, wanting to play like a guard and still some of those tendencies because he was, you know, 6'2 until he was a sophomore in high school are still there with him. So he likes to do that kind of thing. You can't do that, though. Come on, bro. You can't do that. He was so good in the paint, but it didn't matter because he didn't get to the paint enough times. Lakers points in the paint. Clearly, 6 of 26 from the three-point line. Clearly, the advantage is in the paint. So why is your best interior presence? I mean, for crying out loud, Dwight Howard is having an incredible series based on what they need him to do. Dwight Howard is no longer an incredible player, but he's having a big impact on that interior, on both ends of the floor. Anthony Davis, he should be averaging 40 and 20. Instead, in this game, he had 27 and 2. He was unstoppable when he was in the paint. Unstoppable, we just saw it. But he instead took 3 more shots outside of the paint than inside. And I know there's some more because he took 9 free throws. I get it. Yada, yada, yada. The point is he's dominant. And he took more field goals from outside of the paint than inside. He's like playing against children when he decides to go to the rim. They can't stop him. The only way to stop him is to foul him. And he's a great free throw shooter. Just use your brain, bro. Just use your brain. Because then you look like the guy who is scoring 40 and 17 in a Western Conference playoff series. He's been really good in this series, for the most part. He hasn't been as good as he can be. He hasn't been as good as he can be. And that shot chart proves it. I'm really... That was shocking to me when I saw that this morning. And I knew it wasn't going to be as good as it should be, but I didn't think it was going to be that bad. Wow, I didn't think it was going to be that bad. But it was, and that's not the only reason that the Lakers lost this game. You got, you know, you're 12 from KCP and you're 11 from Kuzma, but other than that, everybody else was uninspiring. When Jeremy Grant scores 26, you're not winning that game ever. You got 14 from Monte. The bench was really good. I mean, Monte and Michael Porter Jr. combined for 23 on 9 of 13 shooting. That's going to be hard to compete with. It's just, it's so infuriating because he is so good and so dominant. And they just don't know what to do with him. But he settles for so many jumpers. Even in the same game in which he goes to the rim and he can't miss. Or he gets fouled. Oh, it drives me crazy. Absolutely drives me crazy. Game four of that series, you know, we're basically, you know, and I saw this tweet from... guy who covers the Nuggets for SB Nation. And he said, okay, so the Nuggets controlled and won one game. The Lakers controlled and won one game. And there was a 50-50 game that went the Lakers' direction, and the Nuggets were up by one with 2.1 seconds left. That's about as close as a series can get. And about as balanced as a series can be. I guess that's the better term for it. And we're now at a point where the series is as close as it possibly can be through three games. Now, I think that the Nuggets might lose in five, and I would still bet on the Lakers overwhelmingly to win this series. But this Nuggets team is for real, and they're not going to back down. And once again, when they are in a game that they absolutely had to win, they showed up and won the thing. Really, really impressive. Jeremy Grant has best game maybe in his NBA career. He was so good. 10 of 12 from the free throw line. They went small and it worked. And now it's 2-1. And game four is very, very interesting. Coming up next, we're going to talk to Chris Brown, our 110 Sports baseball expert. Follow him on Twitter at @CBrownSports if you aren't already. We're going to talk to him about the upcoming playoffs, where we sit in the standings right now, what he thinks about the playoff format and who it benefits at this point. We'll do all of that with Chris here in a couple minutes. We'll do that next on the Jamble Show on 110sportsmedia.com. Welcome back to the JML Show on a Wednesday. Twitch.tv/110sports, 110sportsmedia.com/live. Follow us on Twitter at 110sports as well. Listen, we're getting very close to the Major League Baseball end of the regular season. The playoffs are upon us. And here to talk about all things baseball, per usual, because he's the resident 110 sports MLB expert and just a joy to talk to. Chris Brown is joining me on the hotline now. Chris, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great, Josh. Thanks for having me on. Appreciate the kind words, and always excited to talk about some postseason races here down the wire.
My first question is that, do you have trouble remembering ever that we're like in at the point where the season might be over? Because, you know, it's happened so quickly. I'm like, wait a second. Like the season's almost over. We've only played 50, you know, some odd games, and we're to the point in a, you know, in a regular season, when you get to 60 games left, you're like, oh my gosh, like, we still got 2 months of the regular season left. We've only played 55 or whatever, 50, and we're about to play playoff baseball. Is it throwing you off? Because it continues to throw me off in a way that I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, it's definitely thrown me off a little bit because, you know, in a regular season, like you said, 60 games in, we'd be like talking like early June, mm-hmm. like, and then instead we're talking, you know, at the end of the season. So, like, normally I'm used to, okay, you know, we're 60 games in and we still got a month before the All-Star break. Right. Instead, we're 60 games in almost and it's time for the playoffs. So it's a little bit weird, but, you know, playoff, it's almost sort of like the feeling of like, okay, the playoffs are here early is what it feels like, kind mm-hmm. of. But that's always going to, that's an exciting thing. So I'm ready to see how this all plays out.
So at the beginning of the season, we talked a lot about this idea of a 60-game season, if nothing else, does it adds weight to every game in a way that there just isn't weight on every game in a 162-game season. Now that we're basically to the end, would you say that was the case, that there was higher level of baseball more consistently, or was that just sort of overblown from your perspective?
Yeah, I mean, I think it played out pretty much that way. I mean, you know, it's one of those things where, I mean, you know, as seen kind of by the fact that, you know, we only got a couple games left in the regular season, and while several teams have clinched playoff spots, there's still a lot that's being sorted out when it comes to the, you know, the rest of the field and when it comes to seeding. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just sort of this scenario where I look at, like, the standings now, and even though several teams have locked up playoff spots, there's still the gap between them, you know, between a one seed and a four seed mm-hmm. really isn't all that big. So that kind of shows you the importance that individual games are taking, that even in these final days, there could still be movement in terms of seeding for the playoffs, which, you know, could be big in terms of matchups. So that kind of, to me, shows, yeah, each individual game has taken on that importance. And, you know, I think we've seen, generally speaking, you know, more urgency from day one from every team. Of course, now down the stretch, when we've got a handful of teams eliminated, you know, it's becoming more clear what games matter and what games don't. But I think we've seen that increased urgency and excitement throughout the season.
Has it produced results that you think mirror the best teams in baseball? I mean, I guess by 60 games in a regular season, you know who the good teams are. I mean, 60 games, certainly nobody who's, you know, 15-45 at that point is going to make a ridiculous run and fight for a playoff spot. They're just 15-45 bad. Are there any teams that are way higher than you think they should be based on their talent and actual skill level as a team, or a team that's lower than they should be, and that you think if they're given more time, they might find themselves in a better position come playoff time?
Yeah, I don't think there's any of that on a huge level. Like, I don't mm-hmm. look at the top seeds, you know, in each league and think, wow, you know, the Dodgers shouldn't be number one. You know, there's nothing like that. And on the AL side, you know, like, generally speaking, the teams that are at the top of the standings right now, I think, are the best teams in baseball. But that being said, I think there are some teams that, you know, if given more time, would probably be able to, you know, rise more significantly into the playoff picture, or that would fall out. I think in, like, the National League side, I think as incredible of a season we've seen from the Marlins, I think, you know, if given 162 games, they would probably level off to a below 500 team and miss the playoff. Mm-hmm. I also think a team like the Reds and the Phillies, who the Reds are right now in the playoff picture, the Phillies are not. If given more time, they would eventually figure it out on a level where they're pretty clearly in the playoff picture. But, generally speaking, it's those teams. It's not the great teams that are – there's no great teams that I'm looking at and saying, wow, what happened to them? They should be higher. And there's no bad teams that I'm looking and seeing, in a top three seed and thinking, well, how did they get there? It's generally just those teams that are kind of the, between, five games under and five games over 500 kind of teams where I'm looking and saying, okay, given more time, it'd probably level out a little bit more. But generally speaking, I think it's pretty representative what we're going to see in the playoffs of the best teams in baseball.
So right now we've got, as of this morning, the current wild card series matchups. You got the Rays and the Blue Jays, the White Sox, the Indians, the A's versus the Astros, and the Twins versus the Yankees. Are there my more general question is, does this sort of unorthodox, expanded, different playoff format help any team in particular, any type of team in particular, meaning a lower or higher seed? And if it were to hold on the way that it is right now, and the AL is certainly much more seemingly set in stone than the NL is, at least from the team's perspective, which eight teams we're actually going to see. What are you looking forward to in what could be your first round matchups as of right now? And what do you think? Do you think this playoff format benefits some teams more than others?
I think so. I think it's hard to pinpoint exactly, but I think, and I wrote about this the other week, the factor that there's no first round buys for, right. So every team's playing in the first round, playing a best of three. So really that means kind of anything can happen, even the clear best team in baseball, one of the best, teams in baseball could lose two of three to, a 500 team in a regular season,
right.
In a regular season series. So anything could happen. But generally speaking, I think the fact that there's not off days in series themselves until you get to the World Series, it means that you're not going to be able to throw your ace out there as much.
Mm-hmm.
It means that pitching depth is going to take on an increased importance. So I think it's those teams that are going to have quality pitching depth. They're going to have, three or four quality starters that they can throw out there with consistency that are going to find success over some of those teams that may be top heavy in their rotation.
Mm-hmm.
But that being said, that's sort of a general statement. Of course, anything could happen, because that would kind of suggest that, like, the Yankees, maybe they're in some sort of trouble because they've got Gerrit Cole and then they've got some rotation questions. But there's nobody who's really doubting the Yankees have the ability to be a World Series contender. So, it all kind of can be evened out by other factors, like, look, the Yankees have one of the best offenses in the American League, so maybe it doesn't matter that Gerrit Cole is their only outstanding starter. They've got a great bullpen. So there's different factors in play.
Mm-hmm.
But generally speaking, I think quality pitching depth is going to be one thing that we see as crucial in the postseason. And so that's where I kind of lean. We're talking about the AL field because that's, like you said, a lot more set. It makes me look at teams like the Rays and just how many quality pitchers they have year after year and think that they could be set up to succeed. The Twins, right now they're set up to face the Yankees in the first round, which is kind of a disastrous matchup for them.
Mm-hmm.
If they're able to make it out of that series or they don't end up facing the Yankees, that's a team that I could see going far because they've got an above-average offense, and they've also added several arms. They've got a deep pitching staff of like four-plus arms that are all above-average starters. So I see the Rays, I see the Twins as teams that could benefit in that type of a setup. Also, of course, I should mention the Indians. That's the team that just has starters everywhere that could trade Mike Clevinger and still have 5-6 quality starters.
Right.
So that's a team that could succeed, but of course they have one of the worst offenses in baseball. So it's tricky. On the NL side, I see teams like the Marlins. I'm not saying that I don't think the Marlins are going to make a deep run, but there's a lot of pitching there. And I see the Reds. That's the one team I want to highlight on the NL side. If they do make the playoffs, they're on an incredible run right now. They've got an incredible top three in that rotation with Trevor Bauer, Sonny Gray, and Luis Castillo. They're all pitching well right now. So if they make the playoffs, that's a team that I think could be dangerous because of that pitching.
Do you think, first of all, the thing that's saving the Twins, at least right now, is the fact that they don't have to go play in Yankee Stadium, which, if nothing else, is a good thing, that you don't have to go play the Bronx Bombers in the what feels like the smallest baseball field of all time. And then, of course, you're absolutely right that, if the best team in baseball were to lose three straight in a random, in the middle of July, that nobody would bat an eye. And now we're looking at, a two-game losing streak bounces you from the playoffs. And there's certainly been weirder things that have happened to really good baseball teams than them losing two straight, which is ultimately a pretty common occurrence and can completely turn the playoffs on their side. As of right now, would you, if I made you pick a series in which the way that they look right now, we'll just make it as easy as possible. We talked about the AL and what that looks like right now. On the NL side of thing, the Dodgers and Brewers would play the Cubs, Reds, Braves versus the Marlins, and the Padres versus the Cardinals. If I made you pick a lower seeded team to beat their wild card opponent, who would it be? And would it be because of the pitching that, like you just mentioned?
Yeah, I think I would probably go back to what I kind of just mentioned and say that I think the Reds, as a likely wild card team, would have the ability to upset a club like the Braves or the Cubs if they end up, because it could go either way there. I feel like the Reds could be a team that, with that top three, those top three starters, could easily have a scenario where they go out and have three lockdown starts, or maybe don't need three lockdown starts. They need,
Right.
they've got the pitching where they could come out and just, I mean, they could run away with it because of that incredible pitching at the top of that rotation. So that's an upset I could see happening. I know that, and this is kind of random, but I was just reading the other day about the Dodgers situation. They're, of course, the one seed, but there's very much a scenario in which they end up playing the Reds, for example, if the Reds fall to the eighth seed. And that's a What I was reading from the Dodgers, the perspective of a Dodgers writer was that the Reds are their nightmare first round matchup because of that pitching. So that's a scenario where I see the Reds capable of pulling off an upset. On the AL side, I don't see an upset for the Blue Jays right now, likely playing the Rays. I mean, anything's possible, but I feel like the Blue Jays, just while they're a very exciting up and coming team, they just don't have enough talent. The White Sox would play the Indians if the season ended today, and that would be a really exciting series to watch. Obviously, we've seen what the White Sox offense can do. So seeing that offense with a batting title contender in Tim Anderson, an MVP candidate in Jose Abreu, and the outfielders that they have to square up against the Indians' great pitching staff, that would be a lot of fun. That's the scenario where I could see it going either way, as well. I don't know if I exactly answered your question there, but
No,
those are a
that's good.
couple scenarios where I could see it getting interesting.
Last thing before I let you go, what's the biggest difference, whether it be just on the baseball side of things or covering this end of the season? What's the biggest difference between a 162 game season coming to a close and a 60 game season coming to a close, whether it be in your, the way you're thinking about these teams or the way these games play out? What's the biggest difference here as someone who's following it very, very closely?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. And, I think, on the one hand, there's the idea that with eight teams making the playoffs, even on the AL side, where we have six teams that have locked up playoff spots, there's still the ability the seeds could change. Like, the seeding is probably going to change a little bit. So then it's like, it's hard to break down, to get too much into the first round matchups, because they're so crucial. Like, it's a best two of three series, but yet, like, everything could change if you're the Twins, if you're facing the Yankees in the first round, versus if you're facing the Indians in the first round. Like, there's a scenario in which that happens. So it's like, it's kind of weird for me to try to read into it and keep looking ahead and thinking, okay, how would these playoff series, how would this work out? And the matchups are so crucial. And at the same time, I can't read into it too much because we're also in a scenario where things could change up until the very end of the regular season. On the NL side, you've got six, maybe even eight teams fighting for four spots. And I mean, I guess it's not unusual to have playoff races down to the wire, but that many teams that are still technically in it, that's kind of a weird aspect for me to try to juggle trying to look ahead but not jump to conclusions that aren't settled yet. So that's been an interesting thing for me.
And then finally, we're still against the expanded playoffs as a concrete thing moving forward, correct? Because your commissioner over there is talking crazy about there being some finality to this change in the playoff format. We're against that, correct? I just need to make sure we're on the same page here.
Yeah, so this is an interesting situation. And, Rob Manfred expressing that he wants the expanded playoffs to remain. And this is kind of weird because I definitely don't think the expanded playoffs, like they're going to be this year, should remain in place going forward. There's just too many problems with the system. There's not incentives to win your division. You've got teams around 500 making a playoff.
Right.
And potentially teams under 500 making a playoff. I'm not a fan of that aspect. So like they are this year, not a fan of that continuing. There's a possibility that we could have expanded playoffs remain, but in a different way, where maybe instead of it being expanded to 8 teams in each league, it's expanded to 6 teams in each league or something like that. Or, you know, 7 teams. There could be other ways that incentives could be worked in for division winners. So I'm not, like, completely against the idea of any form of expanded playoffs, but I think that there would have to be some serious changes to the way that it's set up because, well, this format is fine for this year. It's not a long-term solution.
Listen, as long as I keep getting my one-game winner-take-all wildcard games, I could care less what they do with the rest of it because that's like my favorite 2 days in the baseball season, up there with opening day. But that is sort of like the chaos of the first round of the NCAA tournament because the idea of one baseball game, meaning the continuation or the ending of a season, just makes for prime time entertainment. So I don't care what Rob does as long as he doesn't take away my my one wild card game. Chris, thanks so much for joining me on short notice to talk some baseball.
Yeah, absolutely, Josh. Always happy to talk baseball. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Thanks, Chris. That's Chris Brown at C Brown Sports on Twitter. If you enjoy baseball, if you fancy yourself a baseball fan, if you fancy yourself someone who follows the game closely and you're not following Chris, you might want to follow Chris. He's really, really good at what he's doing for 110 Sports. Coming up next, you know, I'm not entirely sure what we're going to talk about next, but I'll figure it out here in the next couple minutes while we're over break. Thanks so much for joining us here on a Wednesday. You're watching The Jamel Show on 110sportsmedia.com. Welcome back to the JML Show on a Wednesday, twitch.tv/110sports, 110sportsmedia.com/live. Thank you so much for joining us wherever you might be doing so from. It's been about a week. You might have forgotten, but there is an Eastern Conference Finals going on. Game four of that series between the Celtics and the Heat, that is tonight, 7:30 p.m. from where I am, 7:30 Central, 8:30 Eastern. So let's talk about the game that happened a million days ago. We're talking September 19th, of course, exaggerating more than I should, but it's been forever. First of all, this is another example as to why you should just wait for both conference finals to actually start so that you can actually keep them in line with each other. I mean, they were so far ahead of schedule compared to the Western Conference Finals that they basically said, you know, go on vacation, hang out by the pool for a couple of days, and then come back and play game four of your Eastern Conference Finals series. First of all, that does a couple things. First, that gives you not only, because when you're playing in a playoff series, you have to find the art of adjusting without practicing the adjustment. Right, because you're a lot of times you're playing, you know, back-to-back nights, just every other night, you know, the walkthroughs aren't as intense, you at least don't get to do a whole lot of game speed type looking at your new defense, at your new offense, whatever it might be. So it makes things like, and you're traveling on some of those days, on a lot of those days, so it makes it harder to actually get on the floor and try these things that you need to adjust before, you know, the lights come on and it's actually time to play again. That's really helpful, especially, you know, and the Celtics made a lot better decisions against the zone in game three. It had just been eating them alive the first two games, and figuring out something there certainly helped. A lot of that was they were attacking much more than they had been. 27 assists. They took their fewest amount of three-pointers. They got into the paint. They shot free throws, 26 of 30 from the three-point line. Marcus Smart, remembering that he's not a bona fide three-point shooter and that he should get to the rim when he can. You know, he took 10 free throws in this one, had 20 points. His plus-minus was better than it had been all series. But there's a lot of time to adjust when you have 5 days, 4 days in between games. So, you know, the Heat, you know, they go back and look at that zone, see where the holes are, see what they can do to sort of close those holes, and then they have a chance to do that in practice. The same can be said with the Celtics. You know, not only can they spend more time looking at that zone, just getting it even better, but you've got Gordon Hayward back. You can, you know, first of all, you get Gordon Hayward some time to just get in practice, do some running, do some conditioning to get back to, even though he played 30 and a half minutes in game three, he was gassed and it was clear. You can get him into some game shape. You can just give him a chance to run for a few days, be in practice for a few days, and also just get him acclimated to what they're trying to do against this Heat zone, because you know, he's a big body. You know, him being right in the middle of that zone, he's another guy that I feel really good about him being right in the middle of that zone. He's big enough that he, you know, won't get the long legs and arms aren't nearly as big of a, don't affect him nearly as much as it does like players like Kemba Walker, especially when Kemba gets into the paint. Even if he's about to make the right pass, there are just so many long arms there, and when you're only standing at 6 feet tall, it certainly makes things a little bit more difficult. Gordon Hayward, I think, is an underrated passer and just a good decision maker on the floor, and when you put him in a power position like the middle of that zone, and this Heat zone in the middle is certainly vulnerable, they just do such a great job with pressure and those long, you know, big guys that they have at the top of the zone, making sure that it's super, super hard to actually get into that interior. So that's making it a lot easier for them to not have to worry about the middle of that zone so much. But there's just a lot of time for some making sure things are ready to go, doing some adjusting, doing some of those things, to make sure that you're good to go. And it's just, you know, it'll be interesting to see what the intensity is like in this series. because you just sort of, you've had so much time to cool off. I mean, what's it, you know, there's almost an argument. I mean, we're talking about a break to the point that we're talking about, okay, this team who just got done with their long series is, you know, they might be a little tired, but they're a well-oiled machine at this point. It's been, you know, a week since this team who swept their first round series has played. Maybe they're a little rusty. You know, we hear those kind of things all the time, which I don't think make nearly as big of a difference as people like to think that they do. But it's an interesting dynamic here because it feels like a new series. It's been so long since they've played. As for what actually happened in Game 3 that I'd like to see more of, I love the number of free throws that the Celtics took. They only took 26 threes. They made 9 of them, so 35% as a team. Marcus Smart only took 2. He missed both of them, but that's fine when you go get 20 points on 5 of 10 shooting. Because you went to the free throw line 10 times, that's, you absolutely love to see that. This was the first game in which the Celtics big three were 100% better than the Heat in game three, than the Heat's big three. Goran Dragic had his first bad game of the series. He was 2 of 10 from the field, 11 points hit, with a plus minus of minus 29 in 28 minutes. That's really tough. He had 5 turnovers and 4 personal fouls as well. It was just a really tough day for Goran Dragic. I've been on this. You know, Bam was really good, 27 and 16, 3 steals, 2 blocks, and assist. Jimmy Butler has been disappointing in this series. I don't care what you say. If he doesn't make the layup at the end of the overtime and he doesn't make the three at the end of regulation, we're talking about how, first of all, we're talking about the Celtics being up 2-1, at least. And we're talking about Jimmy Butler being largely non-existent. Largely non-existent. And, you know, I have a new affection for shot charts here. And I think this is pretty telling of what we can see. But in the fourth quarter, you know, he was 3 of 4 from the field, but like he didn't show up a bunch. He had 6 points in the quarter, and I've been left wanting more from him pretty much the entire series. And I don't know if I'm the only one that feels that way, but here's what happens is that when you get a game in which the guy who's been the best player for your team, and Goran Dragic, when he's not playing well, that's when you need Jimmy Butler to go out and keep your team in the game. Because that's a, you know, sometimes you need him to do that. And the Heat are built in a way that he doesn't need to go score 35 for them to win basketball games. And a lot of times that's great. As long as when your team, you're not getting that consistent contribution from the guys that you're usually getting. I mean, Jay Crowder's reverted to the, you know, he's like 4 of 50 in the last couple of games from the 3-point line after going 5 of 9 from deep in the first game. When you have guys take a step back, or you don't have Jay Crowder, you know, knocking down 5 of 9 threes, you don't have Goran Dragic going 11 of 17 from the floor for 29 points. You know, even, you know, Tyler Hero, 8 of 18, he took most shots on the team in this game. That can't happen. There's Tyler Hero is awesome. We stand Tyler Hero. We love Tyler Hero. But there's a reason he comes off the bench, and there's a reason that he shouldn't be the guy taking the most threes, the most shots in a game, even if he has 22 points. I still don't know if Jimmy Butler has what it takes to carry a team to at least being competitive in a game. And they lost this game by 11, but they also won, you know, they won the fourth quarter by 4 and won by 11. So it's not like this game was ever in question. But I'm not sure Jimmy Butler's can do that thing that superstars can do, that you just keep your team in the game because you're so good, even though the rest of your teammates don't really have it. LeBron can do it. Steph can do it. You've seen KD do it. Kawhi. And I'm not sure Jimmy Butler's capable of that, which is fine. But Jimmy Butler, you know, he needs to, in general, I think he needs to be better. He hasn't been anywhere near the best player on this floor for any part other than the fourth quarter and overtime of game one. Because listen, the way that it's going now, if the Celtics have figured out the zone and they proved that they've figured it out again tonight, this series is over. Like the Heat aren't winning this series if the Celtics figure out the zone, because the man-to-man defense from the Heat has left things to be desired. And that's facts. And you bring out that zone and it's been so effective. But the Celtics were pretty solid against the zone at the end of, in the second half, and they were 16 of 18 from the free throw line and ended up, turning in a 54 point second half. If the Celtics figure out this zone, and they certainly did to a certain extent in game three, and if they figured out it out even more in game four, the Heat need Jimmy Butler to be better to help offset that. Because that's been the difference in the first two games. And I'm all for the team. You can't fake desperation, and the Celtics were desperate for a win and they needed it really bad. But I need more from Jimmy. Because if the Celtics have figured out the zone, then we're going to see a lot of games like what we saw in game three. And the way to help offset that is for Jimmy Butler to just be the 25 points per game that you need him to be in a game where you need somebody to keep you close. We're going to take a quick break, come back with some FYI as we round out the show here on a Wednesday. Thank you so much for joining us, by the way. You're watching The Jamal Show on 110sportsmedia.com. Welcome back to the Jamal Show on a Friday. It's not Friday, it's a Wednesday. Wrapping up the show here. Apparently, the Chargers team doctor, for your information, the Chargers team doctor accidentally punctured Tyrod Taylor's lung while giving a painkilling injection to his ribs before kickoff Sunday. I'm sorry, what? You did what? That is a swing and a miss. That might be the biggest swing and a miss I've seen in a long time. He just said, I'm gonna stab Tyrod Taylor in the lungs. Last time I checked, having a punctured lung is not a good thing, and I don't know, man. If you're in if you're in that industry and you need work and you're looking to get into sports medicine, the Chargers might be looking for a new team doctor. I certainly wouldn't be all that excited about my team doctor if he had punctured somebody. No, mistakes happen, and that's certainly that's really an unfortunate error to make. And when we're talking about your starting quarterback, that just can't happen. For your information, the Chicago Bulls hired Billy Donovan as a new head coach. We didn't get to this too much during the show, but the Bulls are really close to emerging from their rebuild, which is why it's different than what the Thunder are doing right now. Even though the Thunder, on paper, have a better basketball team, and in general, have the better basketball team right this second than the Oklahoma City Thunder, but we're pretty close to OKC being, blowing it up. And Billy Donovan would not have survived that rebuild. He would have gotten fired at some point. So he goes to Chicago, where you've got this really nice core of, I don't know what Zach LaVine's doing, but you've got Coby White, you've got Lauri Markkanen, Wendell Carter, Chris Dunn. You've got this group of players who, they've put together a pretty good team over there in Chicago. They really have. And now you get a guy like Billy Donovan in there, a fresh set of eyes, a guy who has been a good coach at the highest level of college basketball and in the NBA. I really like the hire for Chicago. I think Billy Donovan, ushering in a coach right as you're sort of emerging from a rebuild, I think is a really smart move. And we'll see how it goes, but I think that was a good hire for the Chicago Bulls, and maybe we'll talk about that a little bit more on Friday. And of course, for your information, Touchline Talk with Josh Doering tomorrow morning, 11 a.m. Eastern, right here, 110sportsmedia.com/live, twitch.tv/110sports, followed by Around the Bases with Chris Brown. You just heard him on the show today. He'll be live at 1 p.m. Eastern tomorrow as he gets even closer to the beginning of the playoffs and what this is actually going to look like. Make sure you don't miss either of those. I'll be back on Friday to round out the week at 11 a.m. Eastern right here. Until then, take care of yourselves, be safe, watch some sports, and we'll meet back here 11 a.m. Eastern on Friday.